Hello, Vital Sign. Today we're going to look at some really interesting properties of domination polynomials. To recap, the domination polynomial of a graph is one whose coefficient lowercase d of gk on the kth degree term is the number of dominating sets of size k in that graph. Now let's dive into what a domination polynomial can tell us about its graph. From only the domination polynomial of a graph g, we can find the number r of isolated vertices in that graph. Also, if we have the domination polynomial as well as the number t of vertices of degree 1, we can find out how many components are isomorphic to the complete graph on two vertices, k sub 2. Finally, if we have the domination polynomial of a graph and the number s of components isomorphic to k sub 2, we can find the number of vertices of degree 1 in our graph. In order to do these things, we need to use some new properties of domination polynomials. The first new property is that for a graph G with n greater than or equal to 2 vertices, the coefficient on the n minus 1 degree term of the domination polynomial is equal to n minus r, where r is the number of isolated vertices in G. The reason for this is that the number of n minus 1 dominating sets in our graph is the number of dominating sets that we can form by excluding a single vertex in the graph, or in other words, by selecting all but one vertex, v, in the graph. If v is an isolated vertex, then none of the vertices we included in our selection would be adjacent to it, meaning we wouldn't have a dominating set. So when we're selecting our n minus 1 vertices, we have to always include all r of the isolated vertices in our selection. As long as the excluded vertex is not isolated, we can form a dominating set with n minus 1 vertices by selecting every vertex except for v. This gives us exactly n minus r ways to select n minus 1 vertices from our graph and form a dominating set. So the coefficient of the n minus 1 degree term in the domination polynomial is equal to the number of vertices minus the number of isolated vertices. Rearranging, the number of isolated vertices in a graph is equal to the number of vertices in that graph, n, minus the coefficient on the n minus 1 degree term of that graph's domination polynomial. Since the degree of a domination polynomial is always the number of vertices in its graph, then if we have the domination polynomial, we have everything we need to solve for r. Isn't it cool that just with the domination polynomial, we can find the number of isolated vertices in a graph? Moving on, as we mentioned earlier, if we have the domination polynomial and the number of vertices of degree 1, we can find the number of components isomorphic to the complete graph on two vertices. This result comes from solving for S in the following equation. The number of dominating sets of size n minus 2 in a graph G with n vertices is equal to what we have on the right side of our equation, where T is the number of vertices of degree 1, S is the number of components isomorphic to K sub 2, and R is the number of isolated vertices in the graph. At first glance, it looks like we need more than just the domination polynomial and T if we want to solve for S. But as we covered before, from the domination polynomial, we already know how to get N and how to get R, the number of isolated vertices. So all we need in addition to the domination polynomial to solve for S is T. And all we need is S in addition to the domination polynomial to solve for T. Now let's look at where this equation comes from. One way to think about this equation is that we're trying to find how many ways we can select all but two vertices from our graph, such that our selection is a dominating set. Note that selecting all but two vertices can be reframed as selecting two vertices to leave out or exclude. With that reframing, we see that the number of ways we could select all but two vertices from our graph without requiring our selection to be a dominating set, would be n choose 2, the first term in our formula. But we can't just pick any two vertices to leave out of our selection. For example, if the two vertices we did not select were isolated, then no vertex in our selection would be adjacent to them, meaning that our selection would not be a dominating set. In fact, if either of our two excluded vertices are isolated, we run into the same problem. So once again, our selection has to contain all of the isolated vertices. But a better way of putting it is that all of the possible sets of two vertices we could exclude, of which there are n choose 2, we must subtract the number of pairs of vertices with at least one of them being an isolated vertex. And how many of those pairs are there? There are isolated vertices, and for each isolated vertex, there are n minus 1 other vertices in the graph we could pair it up with. So that gives us r times n minus 1 pairs. But hang on, we're double counting the cases where both vertices are isolated. As a result, we need to subtract from this the number of pairs where both vertices are isolated, which is r choose 2. This term, then, is the number of all possible pairs with at least one isolated vertex. However, without the middle term in our equation, negative t minus s, we would still be counting some sets that are not dominating. There are two more types of pairs that we cannot leave out of our selection, the combined number of which are counted by that middle term, t minus s. First, note that there are two kinds of vertices of degree 1, those that are in case of two components, and those that are not. Regardless, for any vertex v with degree 1 and sole neighbor w, if we exclude both v and w, then our selection cannot be a dominating set, as no vertex in our selection would be adjacent to v because v is only adjacent to w, which we also excluded. So how many pairs are there between vertices of degree 1 and their sole neighbor? There are two types of such pairs. Type 1 would be when both vertices in the pair are of degree 1. That only occurs when both are in a case of two component together. The number of those pairs is just s, the number of case of two components in our graph. And the other type is when one vertex is of degree 1 and its sole neighbor is of degree greater than 1. The number of those pairs is the same as the number of vertices of degree 1 that are not in a case of two component. Now let B be the number of vertices of degree 1 that are not in a case of two component. It turns out that the sum of the number of these pairs, which is S plus B, is also equal to the middle term in our equation, T minus S, the number of vertices of degree 1 minus the number of case of two components in the graph. Why is this? This is because each of the two vertices in a case of two component is a vertex of degree 1. So T, the number of vertices of degree 1, is at least equal to 2s. But as we said earlier, there may also be vertices of degree 1 that are not in a case of two component, of which there are, as we said earlier, b in number. So T equals 2s plus b. That means that T minus s equals 2s plus b minus s, or s plus b. This proves that the middle term in our equation counts the number of pairs between vertices of degree 1 and their sole neighbor. I'll cross out those pairs from our chart on the right now. Putting it all together and coming back to our equation, the number of pairs of vertices that we could leave out from our selection and have our selection still be a dominating set is the total number of pairs of vertices in the graph minus the number of pairs containing at least one vertex, minus the number of pairs between vertices of degree 1 and their sole neighbor. Now that we know where our equation comes from, we can use it to solve for S, the number of case of two components, or T, the number of vertices of degree 1, provided we have the domination polynomial and either S or T. As an example, suppose we have a graph G with this domination polynomial. Since the highest degree term is 7, we know the graph has 7 vertices. The number of isolated vertices, R, is the number of vertices minus the coefficient on the n-1 degree term. That gives us 0 isolated vertices. Next, suppose I tell you that our graph has 3 vertices with degree 1. Can you apply equation 2 in the red box to solve for S, the number of k-2 components in this graph? We find that there must be one k-2 component in our graph. Moving on, let's look at a super cool topic that's currently being researched in domination polynomials. Is the sequence of coefficients of domination polynomials unimodal? To review, a finite sequence of real numbers, a1, a2, and so on up to a n, is unimodal if there exists some k between 1 and n, such that the sequence is non-decreasing from terms 1 to k, and non-increasing from terms k to n. If this k exists, it's known as the mode of the sequence. For example, the 5-term sequence 2, 2, 4, 1, 0 is unimodal with mode 3 because the sequence is non-decreasing from the first to third terms and non-increasing from the third to fifth terms. As of the shooting of this video, we don't have an answer for whether the sequence of coefficients in all domination polynomials are unimodal. But I would like to share with you a related property seen in domination polynomials. Let H be a graph with n vertices. Then for every I greater than or equal to 1 and less than n over 2, the coefficient on the ith degree term of the domination polynomial of H is less than or equal to the coefficient on the I plus 1th degree term. What that means is that, up to the term before the n over 2 degree term, the sequence of coefficients is non-decreasing. This isn't obvious because while it's true that we can always form a new dominating set by adding a single vertex to another dominating set, it could be that many of these overlap, meaning that maybe there are fewer I plus 1 vertex dominating sets than I vertex dominating sets. But for I less than n over 2, this isn't the case, the intuition being that there aren't enough overlaps for small enough dominating sets. The proof for this requires Hall's marriage theorem, a theorem that we won't prove in this video, but we will make use of. We'll also need the concept of matchings. A matching in a graph is some set of edges in the graph, such that no edges share an endpoint. For example, in this graph, this is a matching. However, this is not a matching because we have edges sharing an endpoint B. A vertex is said to be saturated by a matching if that vertex is an endpoint to some edge in that matching. Otherwise, the vertex is said to be unsaturated by that matching. As for the other concept we'll need, Hall's marriage theorem is as follows. Let H be a bipartite graph with bipartition XY. Then H contains a matching that saturates every vertex in X, if and only if, for all subsets S of X, the number of vertices in the neighborhood of S is greater than or equal to the number of vertices in S. How does this theorem help us with our question of unimodality of the coefficients of the domination polynomial? Well, suppose we have a graph G with n vertices and a positive integer I less than n over 2. Now let's construct a special bipartite graph H with bipartition XY and where each vertex in X represents a dominating set of size I in graph G and each vertex in Y represents a set, not necessarily a dominating set, of size I plus 1 vertices in G. Add an edge between a vertex A in X and a vertex B in Y when the I dominating set represented by A is a subset of the set of I plus 1 vertices represented by B. Notice that this implies every vertex in X has degree n minus I, because for each I dominating set A in the graph, we have n minus I remaining vertices that we could add to A to form a set of vertices which contains A as a subset. On a related note, the degree of any vertex in Y is at most I plus 1, because that's the number of possible I subsets, and thus possible I dominating subsets, of a set with I plus 1 vertices. In other words, any vertex in Y can be adjacent to at most I plus 1 vertices in X. Next, let's claim that for any subset S of X, the size of the neighborhood of that subset is greater than or equal to the size of that subset. If our claim is true, then by Hall's marriage theorem, there's a matching that saturates all vertices of X. Our claim is true, and we can show this by contradiction. Assume that there is some vertex S of X, such that the size of the neighborhood of S is less than the size of S. Well, as we know that the degree of every vertex in X is n minus I, the total number of edges incident with any vertex in S is n minus I times the size of S. Also, by the pigeonhole principle, and by our assumption for contradiction that the size of the neighborhood of S is less than the size of S, there must be some vertex in the neighborhood of S with degree greater than n minus I, implying that there's some vertex in Y with degree at least n minus I plus 1. And as we saw before, the maximum degree that any vertex in Y can have is I plus 1. So I plus 1 must be greater than or equal to n minus I plus 1. Yet that implies that I is greater than or equal to n over 2, which contradicts our initial statement that I was less than n over 2. This proves our claim that for any subset S of X, the size of the neighborhood of that subset is greater than or equal to the size of that subset, allowing us, by Hall's marriage theorem, to create a matching that saturates every vertex in the set X of our special bipartite graph. What does this matching reveal? It reveals an injection from the set of I dominating sets in our original graph G to the set of I plus 1 subsets of our original graph G. As every vertex in X links to a unique vertex in Y, and by definition of a matching having no adjacent edges, no two vertices in X can link to the same vertex in Y through only edges used in this matching. Also, since every vertex in Y that links to a vertex in X represents a set of I plus 1 vertices that contains a dominating set as a subset, then every vertex in Y that links to a vertex in X is itself a dominating set as well. That means there are at least as many I plus 1 dominating sets as there are I dominating sets, provided I is less than half the number of vertices in the graph. This completes our proof of a kind of semi-unimodality of the coefficients of domination polynomials. That's it for this video. In future videos, we'll take a look at the roots of domination polynomials and optimal graphs for domination polynomials. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe, like, share, and comment if you liked the video. Have a great day.